Welcome to St. Mary's in the Valley Episcopal Church in Ramona, California. My name is Phil Cook, Vicar of St. Mary's. Today is the Feast of Christ the King, and we will use this occasion to explore the very ironic notion of a king, especially for us in America, whose very identity came from throwing off being subjects to an earthly monarch. Thank you for joining us for the liturgy today. Holy Eucharist continues on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be God's kingdom now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy. Holy and mighty, holy, immortal.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, whose will it is to restore all things, and your well-beloved Son, the King of kings and Lord of lords, mercifully grant that the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under his most gracious rule, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is from the book of Daniel. As I watched, thrones were set in place, and an ancient one took his throne. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head was pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, and his wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and flowed out from his presence. 1,000 thousands served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood attending him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were opened. As I watched in the night vision, I saw one like a human being coming with the clouds of heaven. And he came to the Ancient One and was presented before him. To him was given dominion and glory and kingship, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not pass away, and his kingship is one that shall never be destroyed. Hear what the people, the Spirit, is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is Psalm 93. The Lord is King. He has put on splendid apparel. The Lord has put on his apparel and girded himself with strength. He has made the whole world so sure that it cannot be moved. Ever since the world began, your throne has been established. You are from everlasting. The waters have lifted up, O Lord. The waters have lifted up their voice. The waters have lifted up their pounding waves. Mightier than the sound of many waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea, mightier is the Lord who dwells on high. Your testimonies are very sure, and holiness adorns your house, O Lord, forever and forevermore. The epistle is from the book of Revelations. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Today is the feast of Christ the King, and many may greet such a presentation of Christ as the King with the same cynical skepticism as Pontius Pilate did when Jesus was held in captivity. "So you're a king?" asked Pilate. The bleeding sarcasm is obvious, like, "Well, most people who are real kings don't stand in chains before me. I guess you must be a legend king in your own mind. I hope that such a fantasy is working for you." This feast day invites us to explore our understandings of monarchies and then try to reappropriate an insightful notion of how Christ can be a king for us today. We know about the biblical kings. Originally, God did not want Israel to have kings. Israel had leaders like Moses, Joshua, and the judges and high priests. But the people wanted a king like the other nations. And so finally, Samuel complied, but he warned the people that a king would usurp resources of the land. But the people thought, "Well, we need to be good at war to protect ourselves. So we need a king to be good at war among the nations." And so God gave Israel the first two kings at the hand of the last great judge, Samuel, who poured oil over the heads of Saul and David in an anointing ceremony. The Hebrew word for such anointing is the word from which Messiah derives. Israel had perhaps only two real noteworthy kings, David and his son Solomon. Neither of them was perfect. David arranged for the murder of a man whose wife he stole, and that woman, Bathsheba, was the mother of Solomon, who was famous for his wisdom and also prominent for building the first temple. He was also responsible for sending Israel on a downward trajectory, because in marrying so many wives and having so many concubines, he allowed the gods and goddesses of his wives to have a place in Israel in opposition to the one Lord God. On the most part, the kings of Israel did not do well. The kingdoms became divided between the north and the south. The kingly lineage died when foreign conquerors carried the people off into exile. And what does an exiled and oppressed and kingless people do? They dream about the good old days of King David. Their dreams gave birth to a vision of a future king like David, who will be the one to restore Israel to the greatness like during the time of David. But it did not happen, and people continued to dream and be inspired to write all kinds of visionary literature about a future great king. Now, Jesus of Nazareth, in his history, was not such a person. And so the Gospel of John purposefully shares the skepticism of Pilate. So, Jesus, you're a king? Really? The Caesar is the king, so you're a king? Let us fast forward to America today. We are the heirs of a government based upon not having kings. Since we, in enlightened political thinking, came to share the view that absolute power corrupts absolutely. And so we wanted to be rid of the control of our colonies by the English monarchy. What is one of the differences between the rule of the many and the rule of the few? Well, the rule of the few or of the one can be very efficient, decisive, and such can be beneficial for all if the one or the few are perfect and omnicompetent and caring people. But such perfect people do not exist. So the rule of the few and the one tend toward cruel dictatorships or oligarchies with no respect for the many, the common good, or diversity. We now see in our democracy that the rule of the many has revealed the public incompetence of many politicians, many of whom seem to be dominated by very narrow special interests. There are even people who wish for the rule of the few and by the rule of the wealthy. Some even want a return to a theocracy. A retired general recently said that we should have a country with only one religion. What do many people today like to do with the notion of monarchy? Well, we make the monarchies into dream kingdoms and iconic symbols with royals whom we want to be good for tourism and nostalgia and the good old days of our country's identity. The most prominent kingdom in America is the cinematic kingdom of Walt Disney. We make romantic child-friendly kingdoms with child morality plays of good and evil, but mainly we want to sell lots of stuff and Halloween costumes for such romantic figures of kings, queens, princes, and princesses. When we try to find a place in our thinking for Christ the King, we are forced to admit Christ the King is more like the romantic Disney king rather than like the warrior King David, because Christ the King is an inner and spiritual king. Christ the King does not have the same manifestation as the Jesus of history. The Jesus movement spiritualized the notion of the Messiah as being a risen and ascended person of significance. What does risen and ascended mean in practical terms? It means that the risen Christ is available through the Holy Spirit to the inner lives of people in such a way that loyal relationships have occurred. A large group of people came into the experience of a spiritual relationship with the most significant and omnicompetent person of their lives. They did not actually see Jesus, the person, but the constellation of words which surrounded him could overtake and influence lives. And those lives were energized and changed so that they could change the world in external and physical ways. The risen Christ came to be named the perfect, omnicompetent King. He was the only one who was good enough to deserve the authority of kingship, because all earthly kings have been failures in some ways. So while the risen King is like the imaginative kings of the Disney creations, the risen Christ inspires such profound interior spiritual relationship that significant, effective changes happen in the hearts of loyal subjects, but not just in their hearts, because the loyal followers of Christ make real changes in the external world. What kind of changes? The kind of changes which are known as kindness, love, and justice. Kindness, love, and justice have material and physical reality, meaning that the spiritual Christ the King has continued fleshly, incarnational, body language significance. We pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, because we believe that the very best of the interior world of love, justice, and kindness has to be very external and physical love, justice, and kindness in the specific lives of people. The validity of Christ the King is only challenged if we make it Disney-like, romantic, and sentimental piety, and not world-changing, people-changing, love, justice, and kindness behaviors. Christ is idealized kingly person who uses absolute power not for aggrandizement, but for service and love and kindness. We need the personification of the right use of absolute power. And so we have Christ the King to inspire our lives to be converted, to use the power of our lives, not for self or tribal aggrandizement, but for the effective service of love, kindness, and justice. The understanding of Christ as King is the way that we rehabilitate and rightly use power and authority. And remember, if we follow the spiritual Christ the King, we will not live in palaces or in pride, but like Jesus, we will humbly follow our heavenly parent in the ways of kindness for the people in our world who need it. And so in this way, I invite each of us to worship Christ as our King today. Amen. The Nicene Creed is found on page 358. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the people. On this last Sunday of the liturgical year, we celebrate the feast of Christ the King. As we reflect on the meaning of Jesus' reign over our hearts, let us pray for ourselves and for the world, saying, "May your reign come, Lord. Hear our prayer." We pray for all those in positions of power, that they may govern with wisdom and integrity, serving the needs of their people. May your reign come.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for the church, the sign of your reign, that it may extend your welcome to people of every race and background. May your kingdom come.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for Christians of every denomination, that together we may come to understand the royal priesthood you bestowed on us in baptism. May your dominion come.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for all those whose commitment to truth brings them into conflict with earthly powers, that they may have the courage to endure. May your rule come.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for this community of faith, that attentive to your word. We may always worship in spirit and truth. May your reign come.
Hear our prayer.
Here other intercessions may be offered. Loving God, you have taught us that the power of the heart is greater than the power of wealth and might. Hear us as we pray for the fulfillment of your reign. We ask this through Jesus our King. To him be glory and power forever. Amen.
Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Something in the way God loves me
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him.
Holy Eucharist continues on page 361. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame the death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened the way to everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human natures, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. At the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is. This day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all that is evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Post-communion prayer is found on page 365. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Oh Lord, you are our God. You have called us to love and serve you. Oh Jesus, you showed us how to live, and now we want to tell the wonders of God's love. Spirit, our guide and friend, we were